and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Let us pray. Dear God, we give you thanks for sending your Son, Jesus, who takes control and makes the world good, who comes into our hearts and dwells richly within. As we gather to worship today, fill us with your love, with your hope, with your joy, and give us a glimpse of what will be in that time to come. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
The good news this morning is from the book of Luke, the 9th chapter, 28 through 36. Now it came to pass, about 8 days after these sayings, that he took Peter, John, and James, and he went up on the mountain to pray. As he prayed, the appearance of his face was altered, and his robe became white and glistening. And behold, two men came and talked with him. They were Moses and Elijah, appeared in glory and spoke of his decease, which he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. But Peter and those with him were heavy with sleep. And when they were fully awake, they saw his glory and the two men who stood with him. Then it happened as they were parting from him that Peter said to Jesus, "Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three tabernacles, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah," not knowing what he said. While he was saying this, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were fearful as they entered the cloud. But a voice came from out of the cloud saying, "This is my beloved Son, hear him." When the voice had ceased, Jesus was found alone. But they kept quiet and told no one in those days any of the things that they had seen. The word of the God.
So, this morning we have a word. Are you ready for this word? It is ginormous. It's called transfiguration. Yikes. Let me put that in kid terms for you. It simply means change. You know, boys and girls, a lot of things change for us every single day of our lives. Let's see. Does the weather change? Yeah. Look at this weather this morning. I'm on. But this weather this morning is very chilly, isn't it? To your terms. New Hampshire terms, not so much. But it's a chilly morning for you guys. So, weather changes. Is a time change?
Yeah.
Sure. When you go home, you think you'll change your clothes?
Yeah.
Do your friends change?
Yeah.
Yeah, you meet new ones. Sometimes do you change schools?
Yeah.
Yeah. Lots and lots and lots of things change, don't they? Well, I have a story I'd like. How many of you know the story of Beauty and the Beast? Do you know that story? That's a great story. And you know, it's a story that even when I was a little girl was around, so I kind of remember the original story. My grandchildren tell me that's the old-fashioned story, but I kind of remember it, so let me give you a little background on it. It's a story about a dad who has to go far, far away, and he has three daughters, and they each ask him to bring back a present. Did you ever do that when your dad goes away or a family member goes away? Yeah. And the youngest girl asks for a rose. Asked for a rose from her dad. So her dad goes into the forest one night, and he's walking through the forest and gets really tired. He sees this huge, enormous castle, and he kind of finds his way into the castle, and finds a nice soft bed, and some food, helps himself to it, has a good night rest. The next morning gets up, and guess what he takes right off the branch? A rose. He picks a rose, and guess who comes? The beast. The beast comes, ferocious. He comes to him and he says, "You know, I'm going to keep you here. Unless you bring me the daughter that you're bringing the rose to."
Whoa.
Well, the daughter hears about this and she says, "You know, Dad, I love you so much. I'm going to go back to the castle and live with the beast." Yikes. Pretty scary. Well, you know what? The beast was really nice to her and she liked him a whole lot. But she was still very afraid of his face because it was very scary. So what I'd like you to do is look at the screens that way or that way, and let's see what happens.
Oh,
That's me.
Love. He changed from the beastly guy into the beautiful, charming prince because he was waiting for somebody to come and say that she truly, truly loved him. Well, you know, that's a fairy tale, isn't it? That's a pretend story. So, I have a story today that is a true story. You know why I know it's a true story? Because it comes from the B-I-B-L-E. You beat me to it. The Bible, absolutely. Because it comes from the Bible, and it's a story about Jesus who took three of his friends with him, and he took them to the top of the mountain. I want you to look up there. He took them to the top of the mountain. It was a really, really long journey, and his friends were sleeping, and when they woke up, this is what they saw. They saw Jesus with two men that had died maybe hundreds or thousands of years ago. They were shocked. They said, what in the world? They wanted to talk to Jesus and asked him what was happening when all of a sudden something happened. Let's see, Miss Debbie, can you give us that? Look what happened. Jesus' clothes turned all white and he had this great light that went out from him. It was an enormously big, big light that went out. It shined all over so much it was called dazzling light. Have you ever seen dazzling light? It's so bright you can't even look into it. Makes your eyes see all kind of bubbles and everything. It was the bright light, and then all of a sudden, there were words that came down from heaven. And the words said, this is my son. Listen to him. Whose voice do you think that might have been? Who do you think?
God.
It was God. Jesus is your son? God's son. So you know what I'm going to give you, boys and girls? I'm going to give you each a couple of these shine-up bracelets. Hold on to these. I'm going to give you these. And what I want you to do with these is I want you to remember that Jesus is the shining light. I have a question for you. Are you going to listen to Jesus? How many of you have been listening to him? How many of you sometimes forget to listen to him? How many of you sometimes think you need help in listening to him? I need it every single day of my life. I know that. I need to have all the help I can get. All the help I can get. And you know what, boys and girls? Sometimes when you get into dark places, you know what a dark place is? It's sometimes a place where you kind of made a bad choice and you need some help, you get into a dark place, you're going to be a little bit like these bracelets and you're going to shine. Because when we see Jesus, we shine brightly. Boys and girls, look at these. You know, they shine brighter when you're aware in the dark. Yeah. So what I want you to do is do a heart check. Who's in there? Heart check, everybody. Heart check. Who lives in there?
Jesus.
Jesus lives in your heart. And boys and girls, these bracelets will remind you that Jesus is our friend who is with us every day of our lives. And he is the bright light. And it comes to us every day. Because he loves us no matter what, where, or when we are. So let all God's children say,
Amen.
Thank you, boys and girls.
Oh,
Well, my friends and I, who are pastors, we used to joke about this text and say, well, maybe if we told people that we wanted to transfigure something in the church, they'd be a little more open to it than if we said we wanted to change something in the church. Because to transfigure something means to make it, to elevate it, and make it more glorious, and who would be against that, right? Because we like things that are more glorious and wonderful. And if we're honest, that's how we like Jesus. We like Jesus, and we want Jesus to be all glorious and shining and up on that mountaintop, just chatting it up with some old long-dead prophets where, you know, life is shining, happy, and nice. But wanting Jesus that way and actually getting Jesus that way isn't always quite the same thing. I mean, let's face it. If the gospel message was all about Jesus wandering around, being all shiny and, you know, talking to a bunch of dead prophets, we probably would have a harder time relating to him just a little bit. I think that that would be a problem. But talking about Jesus as both human and divine is always kind of a tricky matter, because we can imagine and we can understand the human part, because it's what we see every day. The divine part, on the other hand, that gets a little more out there for us. I mean, we like it. We love the idea. We want it. We just simply relate better to the man who walks and who talks, who laughs and who cries right along with us. It's the image of God that is, of course, more accessible and tangible and real through the person of Jesus Christ. Yet at times, it's also what makes us lose sight at times of who and what he is, which is God. What happens on this mountaintop gives us a glimpse of that something beyond. Gives us a glimpse of something beyond what we see in our everyday lives. Gives us the full reality of who and what Jesus is. He is both divine and human. So it sparks our imagination, and we try to visualize it, what actually that might have looked like. But it's so outside of our experience, and our only frame of reference tends to be whatever Hollywood has come up with to try and portray what the glory of God might actually look like. So what happens on this mountaintop is hard for us to imagine, as much as we try to grasp and hang on to that. And yet it is a pivotal point in the story of Jesus, because up to this point, Jesus has just sort of been sitting back and letting others talk about who he is and what they think, asking his disciples, so, you know, what are people saying about me? Who do they say I am? Well, some say you're John the Baptist. Oh, others think you're Elijah. Well, some just think you're a prophet. And then there's Peter, who hits the nail on the head. He says, you are the Messiah, the Holy One of God. So, good for Peter. He nailed it. I don't think even Peter really understood what he meant when he said that, because it's one thing to know it, it's one thing to acknowledge it, it's something else entirely to see it. When I went to Egypt, I had an idea of the grandeur of the pyramids and the how huge the temples were at Karnak and Luxor, but until I was actually there and I was standing beside them, all the pictures, all the descriptions, they just kind of paled in comparison to actually being there, standing there right next to the real thing, to actually seeing and marveling at how huge these ancient structures actually were. I think that's kind of what happened to the disciples on that mountaintop. It's one thing to know that Jesus was the Son of God, the Messiah. It's quite another to see the glory of God shine through in all of its this glorious transfiguration, this major change on this mountaintop, this glorious shining moment where not only is the glory of God being revealed in Jesus, but he is standing next to two of Israel's greatest. He's got Moses and Elijah on either side, the great lawgiver and the other prophet who used to go around raising people from the dead but was swept up into heaven. I mean, these were Israel's finest, and at first, no doubt, Peter thought he was standing in the midst of three equally important people. I mean, Jesus, yeah, he's great, but I've been hanging out for him, you know, with him for the past three, however many years here. But Moses and Elijah, now that's something. So I can imagine Peter sitting there like, what do I do? What do I do with this? Oh, I've got an idea. Let's pitch a tent. Seems like a strange thing, but that's the kind of reaction we have when we can't know what to do, when we're overwhelmed by an event. It's just, I want to do something. We want to do something, and in this case, he wants to do something that will mark the moment. So there's Peter thinking of the only thing he can, well, let's pitch a tent. Mark this spot as memorable in the history of the Israelites, because that's what Israelites did when memorable things happened, like when Joshua was crossing the Jordan River, he was told to take stones from the Jordan, the bottom of the river, so that they would remember that event. Or Jacob, when he builds an altar after his dream, the ladder with the angels up and down. It's that moment of remembering and marking an event, or when Abraham would build altars every time he had an encounter with God. But just as he's suggesting this, let's build these tents, there's this big dark cloud that comes down and stops Peter. Because there's this booming voice that comes out of this, this voice from heaven, which is repeating what God stated at Jesus' baptism. You've kind of been here with us through this time of Epiphany. Epiphany season started back in January with Jesus' baptism. Now here we are with him on this mountaintop, getting ready to go to Jerusalem. And here we have this voice again, repeating, "This is my son with whom I am well pleased." Then he adds something extra. He says, "Listen to him." I really wish I had the Cecil B. DeMille voice or James Earl Jones or somebody, because I just don't have the booming voice of God. It says, "Listen to him." God's statement as Jesus stands in between Elijah, the greatest prophets, and Moses, great lawgiver. God is stating, no, no, listen to him. Listen to him. Listen to my son. Because I'm sure Peter was thinking that Moses and Elijah were big deals. The voice from heaven says something different. Not denying that they're big deals in Israel's history, but Jesus, the Son of God, is the fulfillment of these prophets, of this history, of the law, all wrapped up in this one with whom God is well pleased. Listen to him. Because Jesus fulfills all of that, all the law, all the prophets. Their time is past, pointing to the one who was to come. Listen to him. Well, darn that whole listening thing anyway. I mean, we actually now have to pay attention to what Jesus says. Which for Peter, that is going to be really tough. Now, Peter was not that great of a listener. I'll just tell you that right now. I mean, whenever Jesus talked about dying, Peter was always like, no way, we'll never let that happen. In fact, in a scene right before this one in the Bible is when Jesus is asking Peter, Peter, who do people say I am? He says, oh, you're the Messiah. Jesus goes, hey, yeah, this is revealed to you from heaven. And then he says, now I've got to go and I've got to die. And Peter goes, no, you're not going to die. We won't ever let that happen. And Jesus goes, okay, get behind me, Satan. 2 seconds later, get behind me, Satan. Because he's not listening. He's not paying attention to who and what Jesus is. Later he says, Peter, you're going to betray me 3 times. Peter goes, no way. Wouldn't do that. But before we get too down on Peter, let's remember how well our listening skills actually are when it comes to the voice of God. Most of the time, what God has to say, we don't really want to hear. And we have that problem throughout the Bible. Moses, go free my people from the Egyptians. They kind of want me for murder. I don't think that's a good idea. You better send somebody else. Jonah, go tell the Ninevites to repent. Yeah, I don't like the Ninevites. I don't think I'm going to do that. Because I don't want you forgiving them. Go to seminary, Rebecca. That's a good joke. It's easy to listen to God when he's saying what we think we want to hear. It's another to listen when God is saying things we don't want to hear. I usually tell people, if you're trying to make a decision and there's something you're feeling pushed towards, but man, you don't want to do it. You want to know what that is? That is God telling you something you don't want to hear. But that is God telling you to do it. And what the disciples were going to hear was Jesus constantly talking about his death and then constantly not wanting to hear it. It was not something they wanted to hear about, yet it was something that was needed. It was something that had to happen. It was a horrible, awful event that is going to lead to the world's most amazing promise that the world has ever known. But we're like Peter. We want Jesus in this glorious moment. Let's pitch a tent. Let's just stay right here because this is what we want. We want to be glorified just like him. What we forget is Jesus' glorification does not truly come from this moment. It's a glimpse. It gives us that revelation of, yes, this is indeed the Son of God, but it's a moment. It's a glimpse into that other world, that other side. Because the glorification of Jesus comes on the cross. The moment that God says, listen to him, the glory disappears. The cloud disappears. Moses and Elijah disappear. God says, listen to him, and boom, he is back to being just a man again, standing there alone. And you know what he does next? The very next thing that he does, they go down the mountain, he walks down that mountain, and immediately he runs into a demon-possessed man. He has to cast a demon out of. This transfiguration moment, yes, it was glorious, and it was wonderful, and it lets us see that the kingdom of God is indeed here among us with Jesus. But it doesn't remove the fact that there is still work to do in our broken world. That Jesus still had to go down into that valley, had to continue to wade his way through some of the muck and the mire of our daily problems on his way to the cross. And Jesus is now beginning that process of moving toward Jerusalem, moving toward his death, setting his face toward the place where he is going to suffer and die. And the disciples remain silent. The Well, it says in Luke's Gospel, Matthew's Gospel says that Jesus orders them to stay silent because the focus was not on this moment. This was a glimpse, but this is not the focus. Something else has to happen first. Transfiguration will be remembered, and it will be talked about after the resurrection, because that is where he is truly glorified. The transfiguration, again, was just that glimpse of what is to come, of what exists. But there's a heavy road to go down before he gets there. And that, let's face it, that's our lives. We know there is that something wonderful. We see it. We catch glimpses of it. There's wonderful, glorious things that happen and that we have been given, and that promise that transforms and transfigures our lives in the here and now, or at least it should. But it's also with that stark realization that even though that glory is there, life itself is not always so glorious. And that sometimes we still have to walk down through those valleys. We have to travel there with him, rejoicing in the glory of the transfiguration, while also mourning the sorrows of a broken world and life. I like to think of us as being kind of like Moses and Paul. You know, when Moses came down, his face was so bright, he put a veil over it. And Paul tells us, you know, forget the veil, let the light shine. We've been transfigured, we've been transformed by the light of Christ, that we let that light shine in this world, even when we're in those darkest valleys. Let the light shine to give other people that glimpse and that hope of what is promised. So we carry that bright and glorious shining face that other people may want to put a veil over. The light of being transfigured by what God does in our lives as we wade through our lives to our deaths. And just like Jesus' glorious mountaintop moment was only a glimpse, we too have that glimpse to remind us that while, yes, we do have to die in order to be resurrected and raised to new life, we will be glorified and transfigured, because in our baptisms, harking back to that baptism, in our baptisms, we are baptized into Christ's death and his glorious resurrection, which means we share in it. We share in it. It is not just a glimpse, it is the full, the real thing. Let us pray. Holy God, we thank you for the gift of revealing your Son to the disciples and to us, to remind us of your glorious nature. Help us to listen to what you are saying, how Christ is speaking to us in our lives, that we may do your will even when it is not our will. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us pray. God of great glory, guide and empower us. Empower your church's leaders to trust your promises as Moses and Elijah did. Shine the light of Christ through your church in the world. From the highest mountain to the lowest valley, let your power be seen in your creation. Help us to protect and care for all you have made. Give us just laws, fair leaders, sufficient food, water, shelter, abundant peace to all nations in poverty, in strife, or in war. Bring clarity to those in confusing times, healing to those in painful times, peace to those in trying times. We pray today, especially for those from our gathered body, Darlene, Louise, Pat, Jim, Nick, Jeff, Wilbur, Greg and Mike, Judy, Don, Jeff, Judy, Kay, Billy, Steve, Eric, Kristen, Rita, Joanne, Annette, Ken, Kenneth, Joan, Bill, Michael, Chuck, and Mickey, Linda, Karen, Nancy, Justin, Cameron, Evelyn, Don, Donna, John, Carrie, Roy, Sharon, Ellie. We lift up a prayer of thanks for Kiara, for a safe outcome from a, what could have been a terrible car accident. We ask you to give comfort and guidance and your spirit to be among those who suffer at this time. God of new life, show us your will for the ministries in this place. Transform us for mission and witness. It is into your hands, God, we commend all of your beloved, for whom we pray, as you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.